Check 1, 2. Good morning. Welcome to Harvest. We're so glad that you're here. It's a little breezy out, but everyone decided, hey, there's something more important today. So appreciate seeing you here and hope everyone is ready to serve our Lord this morning. We've got many ways that we can do that. There's many aspects of worship, and we're going to focus on a few of them through song and through giving, and then just in remembrance for communion. So it's a good day to be here for sure and celebrate and worship our Lord and Savior. So would you please stand, and we will begin our set. Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church. We need your power in us. Seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. Refuse to waste our lives for your joy and prize. To see the captive hearts released, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. We are your church. We pray revive this earth. Build your kingdom here. Let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand. Heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire. Nation back, change the atmosphere, build your kingdom here, we pray. Unleash your kingdom's power, reaching the near and far, the force of hell can stop. Your beauty changing hearts. You made us for much more than this. Away the kingdom seed in us. Fill us with the strength and love of Christ. We are your church. We are the hope on earth. Build your kingdom. Your kingdom here, we pray. Build your kingdom here, let the darkness fears. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire, win the nations back. Change the atmosphere, build your kingdom here, we pray. Would you take a minute and greet your neighbor?
JJ and Miles are here. That's fun. He's throwing you down. Oh. Is he still two or is he two? Don't remember. Good morning. Apparently he shuts us off during... He must have muted us. Where did Brian go? Oh. Hmm. You can't, what?
I mean, we can, but they can't too. We can't change it.
Yeah, because I had like a lot of, I had like Haven like 100% and Brian nothing. And then I'm talking about I had to fiddle a little bit here because I wanted to hear my keyboard, but yeah. Okay, yeah. Yeah. Well, I didn't play last week too, so.
All right, so for announcements, I don't know of any. Pastor Brian, do you have any?
Yes, we sure do. So as we move into the week, Monday night is men's ministry night. So little men, you're invited back church here Monday night at 6:30 as we continue our Bible study on the Gospel of John with Tony Evans. So men, come on back Monday evening, 6:30. And then as we continue through the week, we come to Wednesday. Wednesday is the first Wednesday of the month of December, and we have family night, the first Wednesday of each night or each month. So I want you to be aware of that. And that's, I believe, starts at 6 o'clock. So Wednesday, family night at 6 o'clock. And those are the things that I'm aware of at this time.
Next Sunday, we have a Thrive Fellowship at 9 a.m. So if you're in our age category, you're invited to come at 9 for some breakfast and Christmas fun. So,
all right.
Thank you. Yeah, I guess, is there any other announcements, mm-hmm. Titus? Yeah, so Titus is saying there's a little tree out there with ornaments on it. Please take those, but this is a way that you can donate through the His Kids as they are trying to create funds and be able to support a rice ministry. You know, God works in many, many ways, and this is a way. Thanks for Titus kind of spearheading it and our youth group and kids being involved in the community as well to help feed some that are unfortunate and a way we can help them. So any other announcements? And we'll turn it over to Pastor Brian.
Oh, yeah. Our call to worship this morning is from Matthew chapter 1, verse 23. And we today are officially beginning the Advent season. And so beginning with this Sunday and continuing on to Christmas, we'll be each Sunday we'll be celebrating Advent. And there will also be a special message as we celebrate Advent together as well. And but anyhow, our passage is from Matthew chapter 1, verse 23. So I invite you to listen and focus on God's Word, and then I'll follow this reading with prayer. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son. And they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we love this time of the year as we gear up, as we prepare for the Christmas season. Lord, we enjoy the lights. We enjoy the manger scenes. And Lord, we enjoy the Christmas tree and the gifts that we plan to exchange and to give to our family. But Lord, too, we also understand as we sit here in this church service that those things are not the real, true meaning of Christmas. Lord, we know that. And so today, Lord, as we gather and as we reflect, we once again, by your word, we're reminded that Christmas is about God coming to this world of ours, living his life, but ultimately giving his life so that we can experience eternal life. Thank you for that gift, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hello. All right. Would you please stand and we will continue with the worship set.
I will draw near to you. better is one day in your coast. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts and thousands elsewhere. And thousands elsewhere. Death could not hold you, the veil torn before you, you silenced the ghost of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no right. You have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Pray with me, please. Father God, we thank you so much that during this time and during this season, we get to celebrate and remember the gift that you gave to us, the gift of your Son, and how he came to save us from our sin. Father, likewise, we give these gifts to you, and we ask that you would use them to further your kingdom and to spread the gospel, both here in this community and around the world. Lord, we just thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're going to be celebrating our communion time, and the worship team is going to be playing the communion song. That gives us the opportunity to reflect and to think about where we are with the Lord. One thing that needs to be said on occasion is that here at Harvest, anyone who has put their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior can join us in communion. It's not closed communion, but anyone who has found Jesus as their Savior is welcome to partake of the elements as they're passed, and we'll be doing that later. But right now, let's just take a moment as the worship team plays to just search our hearts and see where we are with the Lord and to confess any sin that we can think of and just prepare our hearts for worship. Once they're done with the song, they will be seated with us, and then we'll continue with the communion service.
All who are weak, just come to the fountain. Dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy. As deep cries out to thee, we sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus. Your heart in the stream of life, let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy. As deep cries out to thee, we say, come, Lord Jesus.
Your will for me, I am only free when you come, Lord.
going to read some scripture out of 1 Corinthians chapter 11. As we're going through this service, I hope that you understand, especially those of you who have kids, that this is a time for you to teach your children what communion is. Nothing wrong with telling them during the service whatever instruction you'd like to give them. I've always been of the opinion that when I hear kids talking in church, that's a good thing. But it's a special time that we set apart. And in our church, we do it once a month, so if you don't get it today, we'll do it again next month. Some churches celebrate communion every Sunday, and I remember being a part of that tradition, and as a minister, had to be kind of creative every week, what I was going to say during the communion time, that it was different because we had 52 of those. But to be honest with you, it never gets old to talk about what Jesus did for us on the cross. Think about the sacrifice that he made. I think that for me, it's more sentimental during Easter and Christmas because I think about Jesus more. These are the words of Paul the Apostle, and I'm just going to read them in its entirety, and then we'll have some instruction after that. Paul says, "For I received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as you drink in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he comes." I think it's interesting that even Paul the Apostle knew that there would be an endpoint to this time. We don't know when that endpoint is coming. Pastor Brian has been talking about that. It feels kind of close for me right now, to be honest with you. This could be our last communion here on this earth. We don't know. But we've been told to follow these traditions of directed by our Lord through Paul the Apostle and today. I'm going to have Matt and Mark come forward, and we're going to have a word of prayer, and then we're going to pass the bread, and once you get your piece, we'll all eat together. So let's. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for what Jesus did for us, his broken body, Lord. We thank you that he sacrificed and suffered on the cross. Thank you that we can take this token as appreciation, Lord. There is no thank you. Let's thank the Lord and eat together. Thank you, Lord, that we can again remember what you've asked us to do. We thank you for your broken body in Jesus' name. Let's eat together. Time will pass the cup. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, again for your shed blood. Thank you that we can remember again what you did for us. Lord, help us to live our lives in gratitude. In Jesus' name. And Lord, thank you that we can celebrate this service in honor of you. And for this time of year that we can celebrate Jesus' birth. God, we will use this time to reflect on you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, as I said earlier, that we have begun Advent. Today is our first Sunday of Advent, and what we'll be doing each week is we'll be having a family light one of the candles that represent that particular Sunday, that Sunday of Advent. Today, Haven and I will be lighting the first candle. And let me just give a little bit of explanation here. Typically, traditionally, if you think of tradition, you know, these candles could either represent like hope, love, and peace and joy. Or maybe you've participated and they referred to like the prophecy candle, the Bethlehem candle, and the angel candle, and so forth. Those are kind of the traditional approaches and celebration of Advent. What I'm going to be doing this Advent season, I'm going to take a little bit of liberty, and we're going to try and focus each candle on each message that I will be bringing on those particular Advent Sundays. Okay, so it won't sound as traditional. It'll be traditional in the sense that we'll have families reading and lighting the candles, but the focus or the theme of that candle will be adjusted or changed a bit. So here we are with candle one for this week, Advent one, and let me begin by reading this. And Haven, you can sure light that if you want to. Advent is a season of anticipation. This year, it's a chance to look for God in unexpected places. Today, we'll find Him working in an unlikely way, redeeming people who've made a mess of things. Like them, the darkness we experience on earth is not just something we suffer through, it's also something we've contributed to. There is hope in our hopelessness, light in our darkness. No amount of shame, no amount of guilt, and not even our failures can thwart God's gracious promises. Today, we celebrate the one who came from a scandalous family line, and became the promised Messiah. Jesus, the light of the world, has come. Isaiah says this, "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Thank you. At this time, I'd like you to take a look at a video.
To be a spotted elephant,
or a choo-choo with square wheels on your caboose,
or a water pistol that shoots jelly.
We're all misfits.
How would you like to be a bird that doesn't fly? I swim.
Or a cowboy who rides an ostrich,
or a little boat that can't stay afloat.
We're all misfits.
If we're on the island of unwanted toys, we'll miss all the fun with the girl and the boy when Christmas Day is here. The most wonderful, 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 wonderful day of the year.
Hey, we're all misfits too. Maybe we should stay here for a while.
Well, you'd have to get permission from King Moonraiser.
Who's he?
He rules here.
All right. Well, we wanted you young people to see that, but you are now dismissed from Children's Church. We'll see you later. Well, Rudolph was spot on. We're all misfits. And I'm guessing that there are scars or blemishes or stories from your life that you don't want anyone to know. And if given the chance, you would send those scars, those painful memories, to an island far, far away. Well, the reason that we want to hide those embarrassing incidents is because we don't want people to know. We don't want people to judge us. We don't want people to know that we are broken. We're misfits. Well, let me share you a truth. You won't be surprised by this. But Jesus knows that you are a misfit. Jesus is aware that the decisions that you made did not turn out right, but brought pain. And Jesus knows that you said yes when definitely you should have said no. Jesus knows. He knows that you are a misfit. I know that's not a very encouraging way to start out our Christmas season. However, let me assure you, encouraging words are coming to you this morning. But you will have to wait a few minutes. Well, at this time, I'd like to read for you the genealogy of Jesus. So I invite you to take your Bibles and turn with me to Matthew chapter 1. And we're going to read through this genealogy, this lineage of Jesus. There'll be a lot of different names, names that I'm positive I will butcher as I try to pronounce them. But anyhow, we'll be looking at his genealogy, and this is the question: is there any encouragement that comes from a list of names? Well, I believe there is. There are words of encouragement. So you'll have to wait. But before we get to those words, come with me as we learn about Jesus' family tree. All right? Here we go. We're in Matthew chapter 1. We'll be looking at verses 1 through 17. And as we work through this particular genealogy, I'll be pausing a few times to bring some explanation, some clarification. And so it'll be a little time before we get through all 17 verses. But in the end, remember, I want you to hang in there with me. Although we start kind of rocky talking about being misfits, I want you to hang in there because there's good words at the end of the message. So here we are, the genealogy. It begins like this, verse 1. A record of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham, it says, was the father of Isaac. Now, before pressing on here, I want you to focus on Abraham for a moment. Abraham is a liar. Hey, he's a liar. In fact, when Abraham went into the land that God called him to, Abraham said to his wife, Sarah, I want you to say that you are my sister. I want you to lie. Tell the foreign nations that you are my sister. Why? Because he wanted to save his own life. That's Abraham. He's part of Jesus' genealogy. Well, then they continue on here. It says that Abraham was the father of Isaac. Isaac, the father of Jacob. Jacob, the father of Judah and his brothers. Now, Jacob, he too was a liar. Jacob, he tricked his father into giving him the firstborn blessing. Do you remember the story? Jacob, he put on his brother Esau's clothes so that he would smell like Esau. And he also took goatskin and he put the goatskins on his arms because Esau, he was a hairy guy. And Jacob figured, man, if I'm going to pass as Esau, I got to do something about getting hairy. So he put goatskins on. So here we learn, again, a significant figure in Jesus' genealogy. He was a liar. He was a deceiver. We continue on with our reading. It says that Judah, the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar. We got to stop there. Tamar. Who's this Tamar? She's a lady. It's an interesting story. Let me talk a little bit about Tamar. Tamar is Judah's daughter-in-law. So, first of all, Tamar married Perez, and Perez died. In fact, Scripture tells us that Perez was a very, very wicked and evil man, and God says, I can't have that. So Scripture makes it clear that God took Perez out of the picture, took his life. And so when Perez passed away, by God's doing, Tamar is now a widow. Well, according to levirate marriage, the next brother in line is supposed to marry the widow, okay? His brother's widow. And they're supposed to have children. And the first son is to carry on the family line. So Tamar then marries Zerah. And Zerah, he too dies because he was exceedingly wicked. And God took his life. Well, Judah says, you know, I do have a third son, Tamar, but he's not of age yet. So Tamar, why don't you go back to your family and live with your family? And when my youngest son becomes of age, I'll let you know and you can marry him. But Judah's catching on. He says, this is not a good risk. I'm losing sons. So in actuality, Judah never informs Tamar that his young son is of age. Well, Tamar catches on to this, and Tamar concocts this scheme. She wants to have a child, and Judah won't give his youngest son to her, and so she dresses up like a prostitute. And so when Judah was traveling to the next town to take care of some business, Tamar was alongside of the road. She was dressed up imitating a shrine, a temple prostitute. And of course, Judah had a relationship with Tamar. Tamar became pregnant. And anyhow, when they found out that Tamar was pregnant, word was, well, okay, we need to stone her. We need to destroy her because she was immoral. She'd been messing around. And before they killed Tamar, she made it clear that, you know, this child that I carry, this child belongs to this guy who has this particular rod, staff, and this particular cord. And it was a certain kind of cord that brought identity to the owner. And anyhow, guess whose staff and cord it was? It was Judah's, okay? So that's what's going on in Jesus' line of ancestry. That's what's going on. Well, let's continue on here. Well, Perez, he's the father of Hezron. Hezron, the father of Ram. Tam, the father of Aminadab. Aminadab, the father of Nashon. Nashon, the father of Salmon. Salmon, the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab. Rahab. Have you heard that name before? Rahab? Think the Battle of Jericho. Remember that? Before the Israelite people entered into the promised land to take possession of it, there was a fortified city called Jericho. And so Joshua sent spies to check it out, to check out Jericho. And as they entered the city of Jericho, they stayed with Rahab the prostitute. Okay? And she developed some kind of a scheme. I know the authorities that were active there in Jericho, they approached her. The king got word that there were some spies in Jericho. So they confronted Rahab and said, hey, we hear there's some spies. Where are these guys? And then Rahab says, well, I don't know. I know they left early this morning, and they're on their way to wherever. And so then the king and his men went searching for these two spies from Israel. Well, when in reality, Rahab had hid them on her roof. And then as the officials, the king and his escorts are out trying to find these two spies, Rahab lowers these two spies down over the wall and so that they escape. All right? Well, anyhow, Rahab did this because she heard word that the Israelites were coming and that the Israelites' God was the all-powerful one. And she wanted to be a part of God's family, if you will. And so she lied for these Israelites. And anyhow, Rahab, she got married. She was brought into the Israelite nation there, the clan there. And she got married, and she married an Israelite, and it's from her seed, you know, her line as well, that leads up to Jesus Christ. So here again, we have the genealogy of Jesus, and we have a prostitute, a liar, in his particular line of descent. Well, that is Rahab. Well, let's go on. It says, Boaz, the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth, Obed, the father of Jesse, and Jesse, the father of King David. Now, Ruth is another great character. You'll just have to read the book of Ruth, okay? But she is what she's called a Moabite, and she was outside the nation of Israel. So the Jews were to marry Jews. That's what they were supposed to do, marry Jews. But here we have they kind of breaking that command. And they marry outside, so we have Ruth. And so she's part of Jesus' line as well. So, anyhow, from then Jesse, the father of King David. David was the father of Solomon, whose mother, Solomon's mother, had been Uriah's wife. What do we know about that story? David, and who was Solomon's mom? Do you remember that story? Bathsheba. Very good. Bathsheba. Okay. So here we have, again, we're talking about Jesus' lineage, okay, his genealogy, his line of descent. We have King David. He sees Bathsheba bathing, he sends his whatever, his messengers or whoever, and they told Bathsheba, you need to come and see the king. And of course, as you know the story, things go on. We have moral indiscretion taking place. Bathsheba, she becomes pregnant because David is the father. Bathsheba tells David, hey, I'm pregnant. I'm going to have a child. So David, he tries to cover his tracks. So he brings Uriah home, who's been out serving him in the army, in the forces. He's been fighting for King David, laying his life on the line all the time. So David brings him back and tries to give him kind of a reprieve, a vacation from his war duties, hoping that he would spend time with his wife. And then he'd be able to say, okay, that's why Bathsheba's pregnant, because Uriah's been with his wife. Well, Uriah, being noble and righteous, he just felt, man, I can't be home with my wife, spending time with her, when the rest of my men and stuff and are fighting for the king. I can't do that. So he wouldn't go home to his wife. So that complicated things. So David then sends Uriah back to the front lines, and he gives instructions when Uriah's up there fighting where it's really hot and heavy. He gave his commander, his general, told him, I want you guys to withdraw, kind of leaving Uriah out there by himself, and that's what they did. Of course, Uriah lost his life. So King David, not only is he an adulterer, okay, but we have murder as well. Murder as well. Again, this is the genealogy of Jesus Christ. Pressing on here. So we have Solomon, the father of Rehoboam. Rehoboam, the father of Abijah. Abijah, the father of Asa. Asa was the father of Jehoshaphat. And Jehoshaphat, the father of Jerome. Jerome, the father of Uzziah. Uzziah, the father of Jotham. And Jotham, the father of Ahaz. Ahaz is a king, a Jewish king serving at that time. Ahaz, here's what we know about Ahaz. He wasn't a good king. In fact, he sacrificed his own son to a pagan deity. That's Ahaz. He's part of Jesus' line. Then it says this, Ahaz, the father of Hezekiah, and Hezekiah, the father of Manasseh. Who's this Manasseh? Well, Scripture tells us, if you read through the Kings, 2 Kings, you can go there, you can read about Manasseh. It says, Manasseh did evil in God's eyes. Manasseh, he was into sorcery, divination, and he too sacrificed his son to a pagan deity, just like his grandfather, Ahaz. That's Manasseh. He's part of Jesus' lineage. Well, Manasseh, he was the father of Ammon. Ammon, he is the father of Josiah. And Josiah, the father of Jeconiah and brothers at the time of the exile to Babylon. Well, Josiah, he became king when he was 8 years old. And he was a good king. In fact, in children's church today, they're learning about King Josiah. So moms and dads, you only have to ask your kids, what did they learn about Josiah? So all you know is that he was a king when he was 8 years old. We'll see what you can learn from your kids when they return from children's church. All right? Anyhow, that's Josiah. He was a good guy. And there's other good kings too, but we're kind of highlighting just a few of the evil ones. Let's see, Manasseh, the father of Ammon. Ammon, the father of Josiah, we talked about that. Jumping down, so we go to the exile. After the exile to Babylon, we have Jeconiah was the father of Ibud. Ibud, the father of Eliakim. Eliakim, the father of Azor. Azor, the father of Zadok. Zadok, the father of Akim. Akim, the father of Eliad. Eliad, the father of Eleazar. Eleazar, the father of Mathan. Mathan, the father of Jacob. And Jacob, the father of Joseph, who is the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ. And Christ means Messiah. Thus, there were 14 generations in all from Abraham to David, 14 from David to the exile to Babylon, and 14 from the exile to Christ. That is the family line of Jesus Christ. Jesus has a heritage of misfits. You would think, being the perfect king, the holy king, you would think that you would maybe want to keep this stuff hidden, right? I mean, this is not good stuff. Wouldn't she maybe suppose that this kind of information would scar or stain the reputation of Jesus Christ? Is that how a king should come? There's a Christmas carol out there entitled, "How Should a King Come?" It asks that question, how should a king come? I'm sure you'll probably hear it this Christmas season. So here's how the song goes. I'll just read a portion of it. The song begins by asking the question, how should a king come? The answer? Even a child knows the answer, of course. In a coach of gold with pure white horse, in the beautiful city, in the prime of the day, and the trumpets should cry, and the crowds make way. And the flags fly high in the morning sun, and the people all cheer for the sovereign one. And everyone knows that's the way that it's done. That's the way the king should come. However, these opening verses here of Matthew chapter 1 paints a completely different picture. Jesus comes from a line of liars, deceivers, prostitutes, men with moral failures, and kings who were extremely wicked. A question arises as we read through this. It's a question regarding this author, Matthew. What is Matthew up to? I mean, why in the world would he include all this kind of information? Now, we can see him recording all the highlights, the good parts, all the touchdowns, if you will, but he doesn't. He brings in the misfits as well. Why does Matthew do this? What's he trying to say to us on this first Sunday of Advent? Well, number one, I'm going to share three things with you. Number one, Matthew is making a concrete case that Jesus is Israel's rightful king. That's why we have this genealogy. Matthew's saying, yes, yes indeed, Jesus is your king. Look with me at Micah 5:2 here. This is a prophecy, one that we're familiar with. It says this, "But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be my ruler over Israel, whose origins are from old, from ancient times." Now, typically, when we look at this particular prophecy here in Micah, we focus on Bethlehem. And it is definitely focusing on Bethlehem. It's talking about where the Christ child will be born. He will be born in Bethlehem. And that was fulfilled. But what I want you to also see in this particular verse, it says, you'll be Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah. So this prophet is saying, you know, out of the clans of Judah, in Bethlehem, you're going to find the Messiah, the Christ child. And guess what Matthew has done for us? he has recorded for us Jesus' lineage from Judah. So he's saying this man here, the Messiah, he's indeed the Messiah. He is indeed the King of Israel. And here is his lineage. Look at the genealogy. He has rightful ownership of the kingship there in Israel. So that's why. So we get a theological lesson here that Jesus is the rightful king, traced through all these individuals. There's a second lesson. And this is a lesson that I've kind of wrestled with, I struggled with. A lesson that I feel like I haven't been able to articulate well. And you'll see that really quick here. So I want you to just reflect and think with me. So here's the second thing. Why did Matthew record all this? Well, Matthew did this because we learned something about Jesus. Okay, the coming king, the Messiah, the Christ child. Matthew is teaching us something about this individual. And here it is. Again, I don't know if I can say it in good words, but here it is. Notice, Jesus is not repulsed by his heritage. See that? I mean, if he was really repulsed, did not like his heritage, he'd have kept it out of the picture. You would never hear about it. But Jesus brings it all. He's very transparent. He says, this is where I come from. These are the people that are in my genealogy, in my lineage. But to do that, he must not be repulsed by man's sin. He must not be repulsed. And again, I'm struggling with this. I'm trying to see if, well, I'll invite you to track with me. He's not repulsed. Now, let's be clear. God does not condone sin. I mean, that's what our God is. He does not condone sin. He does not give us permission to be sinful. He has a higher expectation. He has a higher standard for all of us. In fact, we see in Peter, Jesus says, you know, what I want you guys to be holy as I am holy. So we know that. That's what he expects of us. He calls us to be holy. But yet we see that the failure of man does not disqualify the person from being a part of Jesus' life. Okay, that's important. Did you catch that? We see from Jesus that our failures, let's make it personal, our failures do not disqualify us from being a part of Jesus' life. Sounds like pretty good news, don't you think? I mean, we're all misfits. Remember that? It's how did we begin? We're misfits. Some of us are a spotted elephant. Okay. Some of us are a cowboy riding an ostrich. We don't want that out there, do we? We're misfits. And of course, those are metaphors for what's really been going on in our lives. We have scars. We have stories that we hope no one knows. But here's what we learn from Jesus. Your failure, your sinfulness does not disqualify you from being a part of Jesus Christ. And now for our third lesson here. Our failures are under God's sovereign grace and rule. Nothing can thwart God's purpose. You messed up, but it didn't change God's plan. You're a misfit because of a decision you made, but it does not thwart God's design and plan for you and life in general. We know that is true because from this genealogy line of misfits, prostitutes, liars, deceivers, okay, wicked kings, it never altered nor changed the plans of God. So, on this first Sunday of Advent, I want you to experience joy as well as peace. Your past does not disqualify you from being in relationship with Jesus Christ. And that deed, that decision that seemed to derail your life, it has not altered one iota God's plan for your life. That is what Matthew is telling us this morning. Merry Christmas. Let's pray. Lord, again, thank you. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for not being ashamed of us. Thank you for opening your arms and inviting us, embracing us to be a part of your life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.